that thing on the door?
Ellie.
This is the Brother Jed and Company show. Our first episode entitled Ministry That Matters. And I want to emphasize in our title, Brother Jed and Company, the company. This is not a one-man show by any means. Students are often confounded as to how I can travel throughout the country over these 5 decades preaching the gospel. I have many people helping me, and of course we need host homes, and I'm in the home of Michael Dennegan, an old friend of mine. We go back to the mid-70s. When I first came to the tri-state area, the Cincinnati area, Mike's father, who was a full gospel businessman, invited me to come to the area to speak to that great organization. And it was then that his father introduced me to his son. And Mike and I have become fast friends since then. I also introduced him to the famous Holy Hubert Lindsay, who we consider to be the father, or some say grandfather, of campus ministry in the confrontational style of open-air preaching. Mike, would you say a word to about how we first met way back in the 70s to our audience?
Well, yes, I met Brother Jed back in the 70s, and I had shortly before that become a born-again Christian, and had done some ministry, but really hadn't gotten out of my own comfort zone. And I loved the way that Brother Jed ministered in power, and I was stirred by his messages. And at the time, I was a businessman. I had several flower shops in the Northern Kentucky area, and my heart was stirred. And being a businessman, I wanted to do something that had eternity in it. And I loved the way Brother Jed ministered, and through the inspiration of seeing him preach on college campuses and street preaching, that kind of got a hold of me. And it wasn't long after that, with Brother Jed and a few other associates, that I embarked on a mission on Fountain Square in Cincinnati and started preaching the gospel there in Cincinnati. At the time, I knew a lot of the word, but I was kind of shy about preaching. But the wonderful thing about getting out of your comfort zone, when you take a step out, the Holy Spirit is there to stir your hearts and start giving you words, and the power of the Holy Spirit takes place. And then all of a sudden, you start seeing around you people's emotions start getting stirred up and things. And I thought, man, I said, this is something. And so I just started preaching. I preached the word of God, hallelujah. And it would come to me, the things that I studied and how the Holy Ghost just revealed to me the words that I needed at the time. And it wasn't long that I was leading people to Jesus on Fountain Square and see lives changed.
Mike, yesterday when I was at your church, Heritage Assembly, pastored by Cleety Keith, several people came up to me after the service and talked about those days, that they were influenced too by your ministry and my ministry too, in the open air. Some of the
That's
people
right.
went out to campus with me, so that was quite encouraging. Now, I want you to know, folks, Mike is not what we would call a full-time minister. He's a Christian businessman. We're in his home. He built this home. We're in a very nice neighborhood, and he built most of the homes in this neighborhood. So he is a successful businessman, but I would say he actually does more ministry than most so-called full-time ministers, and has probably done more preaching than people that consider it their profession. And what their main occupation is, preachers or pastors or evangelists, whatever. Mike does it all. Wherever he goes, he witnesses for the Lord Jesus Christ.
And it's fun. It's fun touching lives and seeing people's lives changed, and the lights go on, and all of a sudden they're treating their wives different and their children different. And They're no longer drinking and smoking dope, and things are changed. And it's so exciting because this world is filled with pain, you know. And I know the enemy, the devil, is the purveyor of pain. But Jesus is the pain reliever. Glory to God. And it's fun relieving pain by the power of the Holy Ghost and seeing Jesus touch lives. And the effect that I think that I see with your ministry, it's wonderful to touch students. But the thing that you are most of all, you're an inspiring individual. It's never about the multitudes as it is about the few. That can hear the word of God and be stirred by the power of the Spirit being preached, and all of a sudden say, well, man, that's what I need in my life. And the Holy Ghost anointing it and touching your life and say, yes, that's it. So it's also about touching lives and just the few that see it. Because, you know, it's all about the next generation, isn't it, Brother Jed?
That's right.
This is what we're about, is the next generation. At our age especially, we want to see lives change in the next generation. So that's why in these latter times, we're just speeding it up. Hallelujah. And starting to preach the word more and more powerfully, because it's all about our kids now and our kids' kids. And what you're touching now on these college campuses is the next generation. And we know that this generation is falling away in dramatic numbers, but we want to see that changed in the future. Hallelujah.
Well, Mike, you've been a great inspiration to me as well. And of course, the team, Brother Jed and Company, the team we travel with, I've introduced many of the young people that work with us in the ministry. And I asked, maybe at the end of the year, who's your favorite Christian you met? And usually they'll say Mike Dennigan. And he's very colorful and a very memorable character. But Mike, would you tell us a little bit about your memories of Hubert Lindsay, Holy Hubert? He was one of the most colorful preachers I've ever met. He has virtually legendary status in the Christian church. Is really known as one of the fathers of the Jesus movement of the 70s. Which was a great revival we had in that era. And I know Holy Hubert spent many hours or days, months, I think, even in your home.
And certainly
and was an influence and example to your family. Could you tell our audience a little bit about your memories of Holy Hubert?
A lot of people think that he was just like a hard man on the campuses and things like that. Well, you see, because he was driven by love. And the love that I seen, you know, on the sidelines, it was compassion and love that he would deal with these students and things like that. And he came into my home, and I've never met a more loving man. You know, we went through a time in our finances, that finances were a little low in our house. And my son, Mike, this has been about 35 years ago or so, and my son, Mike, wanted a bicycle. And Holy Hubert took his last $100 that he had, much to the consternation of those that were with him, took the last bit of money they had and went and bought my son a bicycle, because my son wanted a bicycle, and he bought him the best bike that he could buy for the money at that time. It's such a tender man, such a loving and tender man. And I see that same tenderness in you and Cindy, the love that you share. It's the love of Christ. Hallelujah. And the powerful love of Christ, anointed by the Spirit of God, Lord, there's nothing like it in this world. And I just thank God. On the outside, you look like gladiators, but on the inside, you're just sweet. It just reminds me of the sons of thunder, James and John. Well, but in the last days, old John is his brother. Love one another. Love one another. And we come to the end of our lives and the end of our, I'm in the mid-70s or mid-70. It's not over for us yet. We're stirring it up, and we're going to go out with a shout. Glory to God. This is not the end at all. Man, we're just going to keep on going, because heaven is our retirement plan. Glory to God. Amen.
Mike, could you just give a word of exhortation and then close us out in prayer? I think there are many young men out there listening that sense a call to the ministry. Maybe they think they have to go to Bible college or seminary or whatever to get in the ministry. I remember once you said to me, someone came up and asked me, well, Brother Mike, what is your ministry? And your answer was, well, I've been so busy doing the ministry, I haven't ever figured out exactly what to call it. I don't know if that's the exact quote, but maybe if you just give a word of exhortation and encouragement to people, a young man or women, we have the women out there too, who want to get the word out and how they may do it, and pray for it.
And I've never been one to pray for faith, because I don't believe that that's true, you know. The key is getting out of our comfort zone.
Right.
When we're in our comfort zone, we have no value at all. The Bible says the wicked flee when no man pursues, but the righteous are as bold as a lion. The more power you'll get in your ministry is when you get more righteous in your living, and you watch the way you live. You know, in the area of this world where we got lust everywhere. Well, I love the scripture that Job said, "I've made a covenant with my eyes that I will not behold and look with lust upon a young lady, and I made a covenant with my eyes and my ears about the things of God." And that's the key. When we see the pain in people's lives, that we know that we have the answer. Hallelujah. Jesus, hallelujah, the pain reliever, glory to God. It's exciting to me, and I just love reaching out and just seeing the results of people's changed lives. And it's not about necessarily just leading every person to Christ. I've got a ministry of casting my bread upon the water. I just love to touch people along the way as I go. And if I see somebody that might be a little sick, well, I just stop them and ask them, "Well, can I pray for you? Can I be a blessing to you? Can I pray for you?" And most people will say, "Well, yeah, they don't know me and I don't know them, but I just want to touch their lives." It's so easy, and they'll never forget that touch, but it could be the touch the next time somebody touches them, they give their lives to Jesus. That's what I'm casting that bread in the water and watching it start coming back year after year after year. That's what it's all about. Glory to God.
Amen. You know, folks, remember this. Witnessing isn't something you do. A witness is something you are.
That's right.
So be a witness for the Lord Jesus Christ in the midst of this adulterous and perverse generation in which we live. Thank you for being with us for the first episode of Brother Jed and Company.